I was born in Plymouth, Massachusetts. It's right on the Atlantic Ocean. Well, most people are familiar with probably if you say Cape Cod. It's a small town. At the time when I was a youth, there was only about 13,000 people. And I think now we're probably going on 55 to 60,000, really.
But when you were there, it really was a small town environment.
Very small, yeah, yeah. Everybody knew each, you know, everybody knew everybody. We all, because it's such a small, like Saturday nights, you go uptown and you knew practically everybody was there. And it's all changed now.
Tell me about your family. Do you have brothers and sisters and that kind of
thing? Yeah, I had four other brothers and one sister. Of course, back in the Depression days, I think we all had large families or came from large families, it seems like.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Well, I think so. I think there's so many people involved. I don't think we really realized how bad it was. Work was hard. My father worked in the textile business. Plymouth had a lot of textile mills where they wove cloth and stuff. And then we had one large industry, which was a cottage made rope. I think it was the largest one in the world at the time. And years ago, a lot of sailing ships, and they used to make a lot of rope for all these ships. No matter where you were on the road, you could open up that rope and find a little piece of paper in there. It would have the name of the company that was made, and you'd always find it, Plymouth, Mass.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
I think I was kind of shy in school, and I always got along, but they always, I never really took part in a lot of things. And I think the teachers, matter of fact, I always say I flunked sandpile the first grade because I didn't pass from first to second. I think I started kind of early because of my age and being born in October. And, you know, I was quite quiet in school. And one of the things, of course, I had three older brothers ahead of me. And sometime when your older brothers go through and have the same teachers, and then they get you and they say, "Now I hope you're not going to be like your brothers." But I kind of like, yeah. Yeah, I kind of liked school. And as a matter of fact, I think it was in school that I got an interest in aviation, really grammar school. We used to have, at Christmas time, we used to exchange gifts. And being in the Depression, they weren't very expensive, but I received this model airplane kit. And it used to be in the old times where you got the balsa wood pieces and the tissue paper and you had to build the plane. And it had the plans and everything, you know. And I think that started me very interested in the aviation.
Was the first time you were on a plane when you were in the service?
No. Speaking now about, I had a good friend of mine. He realized how we were always chasing down airfields finding out about all different airplanes. Plymouth did have a small, it was just a farm. It was about 4 miles outside of town, and we used to hike up there. Half the time there wouldn't even be a plane there, but we'd go up to see what kind. Once in a while they'd come in. So this friend of mine, his father, finally, he was at work for the Teamsters. He had, I think it was a 1929 Chevrolet, and he drove us up outside of Boston, which at Quincy, Mass. Was a small private field. And he took us up one Sunday and paid, and the two of us got a ride on a private plane. And I remember even the name of it now. It was a Curtis Robin. It was a high wing, you know, a monoplane, and it only had three seats in it. It had two in the back, and the one on the front for the pilot. And the seats were kind of made out of wicker. It had such an old plane, and so that got us going.
Did you remember what your impression was the first time you went up in a plane?
I can remember taking off. I can still see it. It didn't seem like we were going fast enough to go forward, to get moving. We were climbing, you know, and it just seemed strange. But
you know, when you look back at your childhood, you know, did you like your childhood?
Oh, I think so. I think as you think back, yeah, I think we had happy days. I think because we're a large family, things probably weren't that easy. I mean, you didn't have all the luxury of all the food you always wanted. But I think we just didn't know any different because the whole country was more or less in the same category. We used to go up, we had a lot of woods around, and we used to do a lot of hiking in the woods. And I remember at this time, we were at this particular pond, and we got home and said, oh, what's all the excitement? And then, of course, we only had radio for communications those days. And then when they found out that Pearl Harbor was bombed, and we had a local store in the town of Plymouth that sold all newspapers and magazines and everything. So that night, we ran right down there to see the latest papers coming in. And not too long after that, all of a sudden, they built an army camp on Cape Cod, which is called Camp Edwards. And we used to have convoys of army trucks going through the town. And we realized there was something going on at that time. And of course, I was about 1941. I was a teenager, you know, enough to understand what was going on. That made quite a change.
But, did it make an impact on you? Did you know at some point you were going to be involved in this? Or?
I think so. I had three older brothers ahead of me. And my oldest brother was already in the Marine Corps in 1941. He went in peacetime. And then my next two older brothers joined the service soon after, probably after 41. And of course, then I was the last one at home. Then I had a younger brother and sister still at home. He's about 10 years younger than I am, and my sister's about 11 years younger. So I had, you know, a kid brother and sister at home, but I was the last of the older boys. But so, yeah, we went up and we had to go to Boston to sign up. They used to have ads. The Air Force had ads. Men of 17, you too can fly for your country. And of course, being aviation, we just like that. So we got right out of high school. We beat it right up to the recruiting office in Boston.
And when you say we, was this a friend?
Close friends of mine. We always stayed in touch. And same thing, we stayed in touch because of the aviation and because of the, we all built these models and we followed up on all the airfields around. As a matter of fact, speaking of Camp Edwards, had a small airfield on the back side of the Army camp. And we hitchhiked all the way down. It was about 30 miles. And we used to hitchhike a lot in those days, and we're safe. And we'd hitchhike down, walk right through the main gate of Camp Edwards. They never stopped us. We had a lunch under our arm and walking across the Army base, and they had some of the first draft down there. You know, they're 1941. They had the first draftees were there. And they were kind of mean and bitter. And they'd see us going there with a picnic under our arm, going across the, they couldn't realize, and they used to holler to us, where are you going on a picnic? But we finally got to the other side, and they had a small strip on the back side of at that time, which became Otis Airfield and years later. And they had some small Army observation planes there. We'd walk right up the plane, looking inside, and some of the flyers had these maps out, and they were going over the maps. So we'd go over there and look over the shoulder. They never said a word, never kicked us out or anything. But we loved that, you know. So then we had to hitchhike all the way home. We get home, my mother, where have you been? Where have you been? Oh, just down the road. But they were still tied in with aviation, and that's some of the things we did.
Why did you choose to enlist rather than waiting to be drafted?
I think because of the aviation part of it. We're so interested. When we heard that thing about you could join up, you could get into the cadet program as soon as you got out of high school. And like they said, men of 17. So we were 17, we went up and signed up. And they called us when we were 18. But where we did go to sign up, it was also where all the draftees had to go for physicals and everything. But the Air Corps had of course it was Army Air Corps in those days, and they had a separate office within the same area. And I remember his name was Captain Hill, and we had to go see him. He said, oh, he said, if you want to sign up, you go home and get three letters of recommendation before we'll even think of taking you. So we had to go get these letters, and I think I got one like from the principal of the high school, and I think the police chief, and I think another one was an editor of a paper. Well, he was a reporter on a paper, well-liked and everything, and he supported the servicemen in those days, and he brought us up. So I take these letters back, but we couldn't even join. So we finally signed up, and we took the physical the same as the rest of them. It was like a used to be a garage, and everybody's walking up these ramps all in line, all on the new, going to different things. Whoa, what is this?
Was it exciting? You know what I mean?
Well, it certainly was new, because we haven't been that far away from town. You know, we get into Boston once in a while, but not too often. But we're glad we did that. And of course, when we get called up, our birthday was at different times, so we had to go at different times.
So you got called up. When you were called up, what happened then?
Well, as soon as I got the letter, I said, you have to report to Boston, Mass, and you go to the North Station. There are two railroad stations in Boston. At the North Station, you meet at a certain area, and they took a roll call, and they put us on a train, and they took us up to Fort Devens, which is in Massachusetts, an Army base. And we stayed there for a few days, and then they put us on a troop train, and I ended up down in Miami Beach for basic training. I said, wow, Miami Beach, that sounds great. Which it was nice, except they put us up, what the Air Force did is take over all those hotels. And of course, if you're on the fifth or sixth floor, you weren't allowed to use elevators. And of course, it was hard to keep the room spotless, you know. That was part of the training. And like a PFC or a corporal, he was like a general in those days, you know. If he blew the whistle at 6 o'clock in the morning, you had to fly down those stairs and be out of formation. We used to march up and down Collins Avenue, which is the main avenue on Miami Beach. They took the golf courses over and we used them for drill fields. We also, OCS, Officers Candidate School, was down there right beside where we trained, and they had a band. So they'd have us marching, and sometimes we'd be marching to the band. Wow, that's not bad.
It must have seemed, you know, I mean, you're from a relatively small town in Massachusetts,
that's right,
small town life, and now you're in Miami Beach.
I know.
Was the world opening up a bit?
Well, it certainly was, because it's just, I don't know how, because I was, 18 years old to have all that. And sometime, even in later years, I looked at my grandson when he's 18 years old. I said, God, I was like him when I was over there flying these planes. I just couldn't believe it that I was that young. But I think we were kind of more serious in those days. I think because of the war, you know, and because of the Depression, I think we were brought up to respect money and to respect, you know, you had to get along.
You're going through this training in Miami, Florida. You're getting your basic. Where did it go from there?
Well, what happened, I caught pneumonia down there. When we was up at this Fort Devens, it was only September, I think. And it was kind of cold and raw, and they made us stay in a formation outside, and they wouldn't let us put our coats on. And I probably got, so I felt not too good on the way down on the train. And we stopped in Washington, D.C. For a break, and we went into the station. And I told the guys in charge, I don't feel good, you know. But then I felt better afterwards. And I got down here, I think about a week later, we were marching along in formations. All of a sudden, I just couldn't breathe. My chest, I just couldn't breathe. Of course, so I told the sergeant right away about it, and he sent me back to the area, squadron area. And they said, we'll send you down to the hospital. So they sent me down to which was another hotel. In those days, they thought maybe you were faking, you know. And so I had to sit up in the hospital lobby waiting for a doctor to examine me, I bet you half a day. So finally, when he did check me, I must have had a real high temperature. And I was almost, I could just barely think straight. I just never forget that. And so they sent me right upstairs, and started giving me ice and, you know, trying to get my temperature down and everything. And I come to find out I had pneumonia, walking pneumonia, I guess. That's why I couldn't breathe. My chest was... So I was in there about 2 weeks. So what that did, it took me away from... They used to call them flights, so many flights to a squadron. And it took me out on my flight. We were taking all the tests and having all the exams and all this. So I got behind. And then while I was down there, I had to have an emergency fill-out. One of my brothers was killed in... the Pacific. He was in the Marine Corps. He was next to me in age. As a matter of fact, what they did, it was in the middle of the night, they come over and they woke me up. They said, they want to see you at headquarters. You know, I, of course, didn't know what's going on. So by the time I got over there, and they're all standing around and nobody would say anything, I guess they didn't want to tell me right away. So they finally told me, they told me. My oldest brother helped me. He'd been down the Pacific in the Marine Corps. He'd been home, he'd stationed near home. So he got home and he sent me a telegram, to, you know, if I could get home. So they set it up for me, the Air Force, to get emergency fuel right away. So what it did, it kind of set me behind. So when I went back from the emergency furlough, I was just like a drifter down there. I didn't belong to anything. Next thing, my name come out on a big long list. You're going to be transferred to Kearns, Utah, which is right outside of Salt Lake City, overseas training. I said, oh, wait a minute. Gee, I ain't joined up for this, air crew, whatever I could get into. So I got out to Kearns, and they gave me a delay en route, they used to call them in those days. You go home for so many days, and then you leave home and go right out to the place. Well, Kearns was out on the side of a mountain. We do hiking one day and KP the next all the time. Hiking, I didn't mind because we used to be in the woods walking all the time. It never bothered me because when we were kids, we always hiked. So then all of a sudden in Kearns, they come along and they pull all the enlisted men out and they sent us down to Las Vegas for area gunnery school. And that's how I got into being on the bomber crew.
Talk about the gunnery training. What that was like. I mean, had you ever shot guns before, or was that part of your upbringing?
Oh yeah. Well, of course we had, because we were in the woods all the time. And in those days, they allowed you to carry. We always had like a .22 rifle. I never hunted. Some people liked hunting, and I never cared for hunting or carrying a shotgun. But I had shotguns and rifles, you know, in the woods, target practice and like. But of course, it was quite different with this. Like a 50 caliber gun, or of course they trained us in everything. It was kind of fun in a way, because you went to school half a day and you were learning the aircraft wreck and all about aviation and stuff that they wanted you to know. But then the other half of the day, they had turrets set up on the back of these trucks, like regular turrets out of the planes, and they'd have a target going around on a railroad track, and you'd fire at that for gunnery practice. And then another thing they did. You shot skeet a lot. It taught you how to lead targets. Well, they put you in the back of a pickup truck, and it had a rail so you wouldn't fall out, you know. And you'd go along the track, and they'd shoot these skeet at you from different angles. Well, some of them you had to shoot in front of them, and some you had to shoot. That was quite complicated. But it was kind of fun in a way. And then, of course, when we finally got to go on the B-17 to do gunnery, they took us to we used to shoot at targets, the plane to sleep.
What was your impression of the B-17 when you first saw it or rode in it?
To tell you the truth, I was disappointed. As soon as I opened up and looked in that door, and I saw all these control cables and everything's exposed, and the outside skin of the ship was the same as the inside. You could see the ribs, and there was little catwalks in the middle. I just kind of pictured it being like a civilian plane with all maybe having upholstery and stuff, you know. So I was kind of disappointed when I saw it, but I was amazed at what it did look like with the ball turret and all, you know, everything that we first saw.
Because that was the top of the line at that point as far as American bombers, the B-17.
Oh, sure.
Did
sure.
It seem like a big plane to you?
It did. Yeah.
And what position were you training in at that point?
They actually taught us, I trained top turret, I guess because of my height, but we had to train the waist gun deflection shooting. We had different gun sights on there, because the top turret had what they call a computing gun sight. All you had to do was set the wingspan of the enemy plane, and you had gauges in it. You could turn a knob and you could move the thing against the enemy plane's wings. A little bit different, but the one on the waist gun, you had what they call a post and rail. And you had the post out in front, and you could line up the plane. So many they went by rads and deflection and like that. So we had to learn both of those. And I even probably learned about the ball turret, but that never would work out for me because there's not enough room.
And so you went through some training in the B-17 itself. When did you actually form a crew, or what was that process?
Well, when we finished gunnery school, we had to graduate, and that's where we got our wings. I know they had us go across the stage and they presented the wings to us. And so then from gunnery school, I went to Lincoln, Nebraska. And Lincoln is where they put the crews together. And that's where I met the rest of my crew. And they sent us down to Ardmore, Oklahoma for air crew training to help to train as a crew.
How did the crew, was it you just looked on a list one day, or how did everybody actually physically get?
Oh yeah, we never knew each other, sure. They just say all these names were picked out, that, you know, the radio operator and on the pilots and everything. We never knew each other at all before. We didn't even know we were in the same barracks or anything. It's just all of a sudden, here's the crew. And that's how they must have done it, that because they had to make up so many crews.
And in that crew, were you assigned as the top turret gunner?
Well, when we were training, it wasn't really, that's supposed to be the flight engineer's position. And he had gone to the school for flight engineers, and I didn't. But during that training, when we were, as a crew, the engineer would stay in the waist a lot, and I would be up front, because I always liked that aviation and stuff, so I always paid attention to what was going on. So I more or less stayed up front quite a bit. And a lot of times the co-pilot, if we were going on a long cross-country flight, the co-pilot was, oh, I'm going back and take a snooze. So boy, I'd jump right up in the seat. And the pilot, which was, our pilot was older than most of them. He was about 26 at that time, and he was more serious. He didn't hustle around, do any, you know, fluky stuff.
And what was his name?
O'Connor.
And first name?
Henry M. O'Connor. Mm. Yeah.
And one thing I want to clarify is this, why was it that the flight engineer liked to go back to the waist?
I can't remember now why I happened to be up there more. I think maybe because I probably trained for the top turret because of my height, and he was a lot shorter. Mm. And I really didn't get assigned to stay in the top turret until we got overseas, and that's when O'Connor says, I'm keeping you up front. But what I used to do, I did a lot of his work when we were in training. I used to take charge of the fuel. On those gas tanks, you turn these different knobs and tell you how much gas is in each tank, and I used to keep a record of that. We used to have to keep records of the cylinder head temperatures and the oil temperatures, and we used to have to keep records of that stuff. So I did all of that stuff.
Did the crew come together pretty well? Did everybody get along? Was there any problems or?
No. I think we worked very well as a crew, and we got our radio operator was the oldest person. He was married. When we were in training at Arma, Oklahoma, he had her come out with a daughter, and she had a little apartment, and she'd invite us over to have meals and everything, and so like a family. It was good.
Who was the radio operator?
Rodney Hodson.
You know, this is an odd question, but you know, during that training period, you know, did anything unusual happen? Things stand out in your mind during that period?
Oh, sure. Well, we got lost one when we were doing a nighttime cross-country flight. We're going from Ardmore to I think it was to Memphis, Tennessee, and we almost got to Memphis, and it was after dark at night. And we ran into a thunderstorm, and of course you don't fly through thunderstorms, so we had to do a evasive action. And then we got lost. And
what happened?
We got lost because we did evasive action, and I don't know how, but the navigator lost exactly where we were. So we were going quite a while. Now the navigator started arguing with the co-pilot about the directions and everything. And all the time I'm checking the gas, and it's pitch black out. One time we come across, we saw a beacon flashing at an airport, and we circle around, and the pilot, O'Connor, was trying to get in touch to see if anybody was on a mic down there. We heard nothing. And we turned off into the dark. I said, oh boy, this is going to be it. So as it turned out, the radio operator, he uses his key, which is like a signal, dot and dash type signal. He got in contact with our base in Ardmore. And so I think if you hold the key down, they can take a fix. Well, the first time he did it was wrong, gave us the wrong direction. So he finally got him to do it again. So we ended up in Louisiana, and Barksdale Field was a large Army Air Base field. And we landed there about 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, luckily, we didn't have that much gas left. And of course, they come out after us, and they always had this Jeep, and it says on the back, follow me. You know, they show us where to taxi and where to park. And it wasn't too good for the pilot. I think he got a lot of hot water over that, especially when we get back the next day to Ardmore. But that was quite an experience. But the main thing was just flying in this pitch dark. I don't know if we're heading down the Gulf of Mexico. Of course, he flew around this little air base. I guess it was a small one because there's no answer, no tower probably, you know.
Anything else stand, that's interesting, anything else stand out during that training period like that?
No, I think it was kind of routine. I remember that at that time it was hot, it was summer, and of course at that time we had the sheepskin flying clothes, a big leather with the sheepskin linings, We carry them with us. And sometimes you get in those planes when they're sitting there in the sun and they'd be so hot. We used to have a little motor on the back, and we call it a putt-putt. And what it was a little generator, so it could keep the plane ignition, you know, for the electricity. And the thing, the exhaust always made a bad smell. And it was so hot in there. So sometimes, and then we start going off on a trip. And once you get up in the air, it would cool right off. And then you'd be all perspiring on your clothes and everything. And you get way up, and next thing you know, you start getting ice crystals on you. So I can remember that.
People don't realize how cold it could get, because it's not pressurized, right?
No pressure, no, nothing. And no, we had to use oxygen masks about 10,000 feet. And you could tell with your ears, you could always tell because it's not pressurized or anything. You're always blocking your ears all the time, so you plug up when you know. So we went from Lincoln, Nebraska. We landed at New Hampshire, Grenier Field, New Hampshire, which is now Manchester's airport, I think. And then from there, went right up across Maine, right up to Labrador, Goose Bay, Labrador. And then we jumped off there, right across the lower part of ice, Greenland. Then we landed at Iceland. And we stayed in Iceland a couple of days, and then we flew down and we left. There's a brand new plane we had, a brand new 17. And we were carrying mail. And some of the stuff we were carrying for ski troops. I don't know where that was going to go, but we're carrying all, they just put it wherever they could, I suppose, you know, to get it over there.
Did you get to keep the plane?
No, we didn't. That one we left, it had to go, and they do, they bring it up to date, even when they get them over in England. They bring them. We landed in Wales, which is, you know, the western part of England. We just left that plane there.
You know, that's such a long journey. I mean, what do you remember about that trip over there?
Well, I remember looking down, going across Greenland, nothing but snow, and you know, it looked like a great big floating iceberg. Of course, when we got to Iceland, of course, some of the ground crew come running out wanting to know what's going on in the United States and everything. They're lonely, you know. The Quonset huts were kind of set back into the not mountains, but they were set back into the hills. Like half the Quonset hut was underground because of I suppose it had storms and everything. I remember the runways on either side of the runway was all great big like rocks and stuff. If you ever went off the runway, forget it. I think they didn't have too much food for the air crews there, unless they were hoarding it for themselves. So we're glad to kind of leave there. But one thing that did happen when we left there going to Wales. The only contact we would have would be through the radio operator because at that time, communications, talking, you wouldn't go that far. So he had the key and the coded stuff. And one time he sent a message out, I don't know if it was back to Iceland, but right away you got an answer, a quick answer. And they used to tell us that the German submarines would be up there and they would listen in, and if they could, and they turn around and send the wrong directions. They try to send you directions, which would be the wrong way to go, to get you to go up in the North Atlantic somewhere, you know. And I guess that did happen a couple of times with some of the crews. That happened. We figured it out that it must have been, because it was all the wrong codes and everything, that they gave the wrong information.
Well, you made it safely to Wales then.
Yeah, and right across the island, over to Wales.
And had to give up the plane. And so where did you go from there?
Okay, from Wales, we went to what they call Stone England. It was another, probably like a distribution place where they sent air crews off to different places. So from there, we left and we had to go to London. We were on our own, on the train, just the crew, you know, carrying all our luggage and everything. You know, nobody carried stuff way over there during wartime. So we got into London and we were on the train to go out to this, where the 390th Bomb Group that I was assigned to in the 8th Air Force. And so of course we put all our luggage on the train and we saw, we're standing out there talking and finally they blew the whistle, the train's moving out. The conductor wouldn't let us on. No, the whistle, the doors are all closed. So the train takes off with all our luggage. It was stuck in Boston, in London. So we had to stay there for the weekend.
Without luggage.
Yeah. Then here we had flying clothes on, everything. So we had to go to the MPs in London and get special passes. And we had to explain to them what had gone on. And of course, at night there, it's a great big city, and we didn't know anything about it. And
what What was wartime London like? Could you tell by just looking at the city that there was a war on?
Oh, you certainly could, yeah, yeah. Because, see, this was 1944, but the city of London itself, there was no buildings. And they built walls around. They pushed all the rubble inside where the buildings were, and then they built walls around. So when you're riding around, but then you did see some buildings, and the building would be cut right in half. You see bathtubs hanging out way up the third or fourth story. Or, you know, the building just cut right down from the bombing. No windows left anywhere. Like all the windows in the whole city must have been just shattered, you know.
Did you ever go down into the subway?
Oh, yeah, the tube. Yeah, they call it the tube over there.
What was it like down there?
Well, first thing, boy, this thing goes down. They were so far underground. I was so used to the ones in Boston, you just go down like one story in the subway car, and that one, sometimes you go down two or three stories to get in. But they were neat. But the main thing with that, when we went down into the subways, the people would be down there, and it was like air raid shelters. And all along the walls, they would have, you know, at the stations, they'd have these bunks. And people just stayed down there. And it was drafty and cold and everything, but they would use them for air raid shelters.
So were they living down there, or were they?
At night, they would go down there at night. Oh. So they'd have to come out and go to work, even if they were bombed. There's people, you know, we just don't realize, I guess, or some people don't realize what the civilians went to in that. And then, of course, they had the buzz bombs and then the rockets that they had toward the end of the war, which is...
Talk about the arrival at the Framlingham base. Do you remember what your impression was of the place, or what you thought when you saw it?
Well, of course, we had Quonset huts to stay in, which weren't too bad, but they weren't finished often or anything inside, and they were kind of damp and cold. And they had a little stove inside, a little about the size of a stove pipe, really. And of course, the coal was, they used to ration the coal to us to keep the thing going. It didn't get extremely, well, it did get kind of cold. It was winter time, you know, when we started flying, but it didn't get cold like it does here in the north, where it gets down around zero or anything. But it was cold and damp, though.
How was the food and that kind of thing, eating there on the base?
I didn't think the food was too bad. Of course, we used these powdered eggs a lot, which nobody really cared for. I guess they made them dehydrated eggs, and then they sent them over as a powder. And depends how, if the cook knew how to really fix them, they put a little onion in them and stuff, it was not too bad. But we had quite a bit of that. All the wood, and we were going on missions. They used to try to give us fried eggs.
Real eggs?
But I just couldn't eat fried eggs at 2 or 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. That's just, you know, so I'd always just have some dried bread and whatever coffee they had. I think the coffee was instant coffee. I think it was when they first started making instant coffee. They had a great big vat of the stuff. Nothing like coffee you buy now. But
how big was the base? I mean, was it just a dinky little thing with a runway, or was it?
No. It was built on a farm that belonged to this particular farmer, and it took up just about the whole territory. Because what they did, because of bombing and stuff, they put the squadron areas in different places. Like I was in the 571st Squadron, where we were quite a ways away from the field. And we all had to have bicycles, really, to get around. Other squadron areas would be probably half a mile some other direction. So right around the whole field, all the buildings, even headquarters, were separated. You know, we're kind of separated a lot. And that's mainly because of the bombings, you know, so they couldn't have us all concentrated too tight. So we were all quite a ways from the field itself.
Did you interact with the locals at all?
We didn't get out. Some people did, I think. They got down and to mix in. They used to get down to the pub, because I was so young, I wasn't a drinker or anything. But some of the guys were what they used to call going over the hill, because there was no boundaries. I mean, you just go out of your hut and you go over down the path and you're down into the local village. There'd be pubs down there, and some of the older guys would be go down there, probably do drinking and stuff. Although we did have what they call a bitchin' post on the base, and they had beer. And then they had a rocket club for staff sergeant up. That was a club where you could go. They used to have dances, and they had booze there, drinking, you know. And of course, the officers had their own club. So there was places to drink right on the base, but those that wanted to. But most of us, most of my crew, we didn't drink, because I guess our age, we weren't, you know.
How did you spend your off time? I'm going to get into missions in a minute, but I mean, your off time, how did you, how'd you occupy your time?
Well, I think the commanding officer we had, Colonel Moeller, pretty strict on training. We did a lot of, if we weren't flying missions, he had us going to a lot of schools. So we'd go to what they call jam handy school. You go and shoot at targets on make-believe shooting, like it's like going to the penny arcade, you know, we have these special things. Well, he had us doing a lot of stuff on training. Even though we're flying combat, he still kept us training, which is, and then he used to fly practice missions for all the crews. They have to get up and fly practice missions when you weren't flying a regular mission. So he kept us pretty well going.
Do you remember your first mission?
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
Tell us about it, because there must have been anticipation and that kind of thing.
Well, the first thing that happened, they usually put up what they call battle laws at night. They post who was going to fly at the squadron headquarters, and if you see your name there, then you know. So we knew we were going to go on a mission, and so what happened the next morning, we went. They didn't come down and wake us up. And so they come down quite a bit later. The pilot and all the officers were all getting ready. Where's the crew? And they're supposed to wake us up, and they didn't. And so they come rushing down to get us, and they rush us up to get something to eat. And then instead of going to the regular briefings like you always go through, they just gave us a quick briefing. I said, oh, our first mission, here we're going on this. Well, I think the biggest thing, because the mission, never realizing how long it took to get into formation and the altitude, because you get all these planes, got to get up there and get in this formation before you head to Europe. And that took quite a while. I was quite amazed at that. But the biggest thing, when I saw the stream of bombers ahead of us and behind us, I just couldn't believe there were so many planes that were involved. We finally get up and slip into the stream, what they call the bomber stream. One field, another field, it just went on. And then sometimes they get over Germany, and some would break off and go to other targets. And I was just amazed at so many, to look back and forth and see so many planes up in the air at one time. I never realized it was that heavy a concentration on planes that we had at the time.
So, carry on. Tell us about that. You got up into the stream, and what happened?
Well, we got going across the channel. Of course, then the first time we see, when it was an aircraft, which we knew nothing about, you used to hear him talk about it and everything. And our bombardier, because he's right up front, he's got that good picture of what's going on. And of course, they call it flak. I said, oh, flak at 12 o'clock. And as soon as you hear that, you say, oh, so and that's the first time we ever saw any aircraft. These little black puffs of things puffing up, coming around. But the first thing that amazed me, I think we were in, they used to put us in three squadron groups. There'd be the lead squadron, the low, and then the high. I think we're in the low, or maybe the lead. And all of a sudden, I happened to be looking up, because being in the top turret, I could see a lot of what's going on up top. And all of a sudden, I see a plane up top. And I said, what's he doing? And all of a sudden, he just flipped right up and just went into a roll, just went right down. Well, he must have had a direct hit right in the cockpit. I didn't say, what's this guy doing? I didn't realize he got hit by flak. So the first mission was the first plane went down. So what's up?
There must have been a point where it dawned on you that this was very serious business.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And, you're really nervous and you're afraid. I mean, you're afraid what's going to happen, especially when you see that stuff. And then, of course, then you're looking for the fighters. You've got to be warning about that. And they were scary to go, and I don't think you ever toughened up to it.
So you went into the bomb run. Do you remember where that mission went?
Oh yeah, I think the first one was Hanover, Germany. I think we were going after rail yards. We did 35, and you can't really separate certain ones you could separate, maybe the real worst ones. But the ones in between, it's hard to remember. Which one this happened, which one that happened.
But that first mission to Hanover, Did you come through that okay?
We didn't get any, we didn't get too much battle damage, you know, at that time, which was good. And we stayed in the formation, which was good. Because in future missions, next thing you know, we're out by ourselves because you lose engines. And
you said that you flew 35 missions. You're obviously not going to remember every mission, but were there missions that stood out in your mind?
Well, I think probably our worst mission was our 10th mission, and it was Merseburg, Germany, with synthetic oil refineries where they were making this out of, I guess, out of coal or whatever. And of course, at that time, Germany really hard up for oil. They really needed the gas and stuff. And that was kind of a tough mission. That's Merseburg is not too far south of Berlin. It was quite a run in. And I think what finally happened on the bomb run, the group ahead of us slipped in front of us and made us, because you go one group after the other, not exactly behind each other, but they were, and they started on a bomb run, they slipped in front of us, they got out of position and made us make a turn. And when we made the turn, we had to make a different approach to this Merseburg, and we were what they call Zeitz, Germany, which is another hot spot. And all hell broke loose as far as the anti-aircraft. It was miserable. It was awful. Everywhere you look, you could see this black, you know, clouds of black stuff puffing all over the place. And of course, we were being hit by shrapnel all the time. And I think they said we were about 37 minutes to do that whole mission. It's just constant flak, which is very unusual to be in it that long without getting out. And of course, our tail gunner was wounded. He was pretty badly wounded. And then I get hit in the head with a piece of flak coming right through the top of the turret, and just lucky, it just bounced off the back of my head.
Did you have a helmet on?
That's the big problem. When I come back and I went to the flight surgeon, first thing he did, he started ripping me out. You have your helmet on? I says, well, I'll tell you the truth, I was standing on it. I wanted to see. So I had it right in the middle of the turret, I was standing on top of it, which was kind of stupid on my part, I guess. You know, I think when you're 18 years old, you don't think anything's going to happen to you. Although we were all scared stiff, you know. And I used to take the 50 caliber machine guns and I'd pull them down level so it'd be beside my head for a little bit of protection. Never thought that I'd better have that helmet on. So he racked me out for that, the flight surgeon, when I got back, so I faded away. But that was probably our worst mission.
Were there other missions that, for whatever reason, stand out in your mind?
No, I think another one, at one time, I had a piece of shrapnel come through the dome, or through my turret glass, and I got, it's plexiglass, so it breaks up like sand, which is, I guess is lucky. It's just like somebody took a fistful of sand and threw it in my eyes. It just hit me on this right. And I thought I was blind. I thought I had it. And I jumped out of the tower and I said, oh, what am I going to do? I can't see what I'm doing or anything. So finally, my eyes watered and I got enough and it washed out. Luckily, I could see all right. That scared the heck out of me. I think one other time.
Was that flak that had hit it?
Yeah, a piece of shrapnel come through, a flak. Yeah, just come right through, and went down inside the turret somewhere. I should have probably found it and kept it. But that was an incident. Another time, we were getting in formation, and there's a lot of what they call prop wash on the group ahead of you that makes it heavy from their propellers.
Turbulence.
One time, we just flipped, and we hit this prop wash, and we flipped over. And when we did, some of the cables in the turret, we always wore a parachute harness, but I couldn't wear the parachute in the turret. But we had the harness, and it had little clips on the side that you snap the chute on. One of the clips hooked onto the cable, and I got hung up in the cable, and we're kind of slipping like that. And I almost panicked. I said, here I am, I'm stuck. Can I get my hands up and get the thing off? And I always remember that happened. And he finally got it straightened out, and we got back into the formation. And I finally got the thing. But those crazy things happen sometimes. You don't even realize it. But how the heck did the thing? I must have went up and there's a piece of cable that went to the either to the guns or whatever, and it snapped on that hook clip. And of course, you can't get them off. I'm trying to get my hands up there. We're down going. I'm seeing the ground down there.
Just a little momentary panic.
It's just a little thing. Just to remember those things. You know that.
Did you ever lose engines?
Oh yeah, Yeah, quite a few times we lost one engine through either the engine, through flak usually. Sometimes the tanks, the gas tanks going to the engine would get flak holes in them. Mostly it's engine damage from flak most of the time. I think one time we lost two. Well, we had two good engines and one hardly working at all. And the B-17 was a good plane for flying. You could fly on one engine if you had to, I think.
Would you be able to stay up with the group when you'd lose an engine?
No, you leave formation. You just have to fall out. You can't stay with the formation. Then, of course, when you're on your own, and the pilot, we had good fighter protection. The Mustang came out just about the time that we got there, the P-51 Mustang, and they were excellent protection because they were good against the German planes. They were really good, and I think that saved us a lot more than anything. And the other biggest thing that saved us, our commanding officer was very strict on tight flying formations. I don't know, you probably talked to some of the pilots. And they're very strict on keeping a tight formation, because when you had a tight formation, depending on where we were in the formation, I could patrol one area with my guns on the top turret. If I'm on one side, I keep charge of, I'd patrol on one different area. And of course, everybody did the same thing, so you had a good group of guns all the way around you. And of course, I think the Germans would look over the whole formation, and if they see these sloppy flying group, that's the one they'd go down and jump on. They're easier for them, easier targets.
You always made it back to the base, though, right? You never had a forced landing or anything like that?
When we had the wounded, when Bill Johnson was wounded, we were wondering if maybe Belgium had just about been taken over, part of Belgium. So, well, if there's a field, maybe we better land to get him medical. I said, well, they might not have as good a medical. So we all talked it over, we better try to get back, and which we did, and which I think was good, because he got to a general hospital in England, which was much better than, because if they just took that land over, the infantry and everything, you don't know what they'd have for medical aid,
Did you ever have missions where you were really wondering whether you had enough fuel to get back?
I think one time it was a long mission, and we had to go to the Russian front after there was, I think it was a railroad bridge. It was to help Russia, because I remember at the time they gave us these like a pullover thing with a Russian and American flag on it to identify ourselves. Great big flags, and it said underneath that we were Americans, because they claimed if you get shot down over there, if you bailed out, they don't ask questions. They think you're Germans or something, they shoot you. So we had these big things. So I remember that was a long mission, and coming back, we did end up coming back okay.
Because you would have been responsible for moving that fuel between the tanks to get maximum.
Transfer on the fuel So it didn't have to do too much transfer on. We usually ended up in pretty good shape. It's on it.
Were there any missions where you actually shot at other at German aircraft?
We were very fortunate at enemy fighters. They're in the area. I remember one time, I think we were going to Hamburg, Germany, with submarine pens, and all of a sudden, way up ahead on the bomber stream, was a big air battle going on. And I said, "Boy, we're going to be up there in about 2 minutes. We're going to be in right in the middle of it." And well, I couldn't distinguish who they were, but there was these orange fighter planes going down, both all over the planet, 17s. And by the time, probably 5 minutes later, we got up there, everything was gone. It just ended. It just like it started. I was glad. So, we never really got heavily, when I was flying, we never really got, on any mission I was on, attacked bad with enemy fighters, but our group did get attacked bad probably a couple of times where we lost almost the whole squadron. Mm-hmm. But our biggest loss is more from anti-aircraft than from German fighters. That Merseburg mission, we lost, I think, 9 planes just on that.
Yeah. Any other missions that stand out, or unusual things that happen, or things that stand out in your mind on those missions?
I think a lot of it was routine. I think one time, I think it was Christmas Day. I don't know if you know of the Battle of the Bulge that they had. Germany had broken the American lines, and they started heading for Antwerp. And on the British Channel. And we were grounded, I think, December 16th, right up to the day before Christmas. We just couldn't get off. And I think Christmas Day, we finally got off. And we went after, I think, some bridges, something behind the German lines. And when we're coming back, everything is fairly quiet. And all of a sudden, I happen to look up, and there's this jet coming, barreling right toward us. And of course, it was a German, a 262, which is their jet. And that thing was going so fast, and by the time I tried to switch the tower around, well, the tower's going like that, and in the meantime, he's just, so I think he made a pass at our, I think we're in a high squadron. He made a pass, and he just got beyond us, and he flipped right over and went down, and he made a pass at the low squadron, and then he disappeared. I don't even know, I don't think he was shooting us, but then sometimes when they shoot it, you can see the little lights, like look like little sparklers that when they're doing it. So I don't know if it's some German pilot just hustling around up there, what he was doing, but that thing was moving. I'm glad he didn't have me early in the war, because
Did you know about the jets at point?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because we used to have a library, a combat library, right on the base. And you could go down and they would tell you anything to do with anything they thought was secret with us or well with Germany. We did have jets in this country, but they weren't perfected as good as, I don't think, the German jet. And of course, then they had the 163, which is a rocket-propelled type plane. We always had to watch for those. They always warned us what to watch for.
Well, was there a point, you knew that your tour was over at 35 missions, was there sort of a countdown at some point where you were waiting to get to 35?
No, I thought we probably start get excited, but you don't, a lot of superstitions went on, I think, with air crews at that time, and you didn't want to, like, whatever you wore, you always tried to wear the same thing.
Did you have superstitions or anything you'd do habitually, or?
I didn't carry anything, or but I think maybe, probably not as bad as some of them. I know the radio operator, he had a pair of shoes of his daughter's, and he always carried those. And some of them would carry different things. They wouldn't do different things. They wouldn't wear their clothes different because they didn't want any changes. But there was always a fear of having to fly with another crew. You just didn't want to. You wanted to stay with your own crew. I had a chance to go on a program going at Thanksgiving time, being from Plymouth, Massachusetts, and so they wanted to make a program from Plymouth, England, where the pilgrims that left Plymouth, England can move. So they called me from headquarters. We're watching a movie, and I got this call to get down to headquarters. I said, oh, what have I done now? What's going on? So when I did, they told me about what was going on. If I'd go in and see this Colonel Ben Loyne, who was an old-time movie actor, but he's in charge of special services, and he make an arrangement with the BBC to have the special program from Plymouth, England to Plymouth, Massachusetts, and have the GIs that were from Plymouth that could round them up. So first I said, I didn't want to go because I was afraid the crew would go without me. That meant everything. I didn't want them, then I'd have to make up a mission with another crew. If anything happened to them, I wouldn't want to be not there, So I finally went anyway. But they did, they kept the crew down for about 5 days till I got back, which I was glad. It just happened they didn't need them in the rotation, apparently. I was lucky.
Were you actually on this radio program?
Yes. Yeah.
What was that like?
Well, it was. I had to go into London, and of course, when I got into the station, you go over to Grosvenor Square, where all the American offices buildings were there. As a matter of fact, there's a big statue of General Eisenhower right outside of Grosvenor Square now. So I had to go there and find this Colonel Ben Loyne's office. Of course, I got lost in London going over. I should have probably taken a cab, which I tried to walk, so I finally found it. And when I got into his office, strangely, there was a bunch of women in there, and all dressed up like party, and they were having cocktails. I said, wow, this guy, I'm thinking to myself, boy, this guy got it made. So anyway, he sent me down to see the fellow downstairs from the BBC, and they had this program all arranged, and it's to do with Americans coming over to help them now, and of course the Pilgrims left England years ago, and like them Pilgrims coming back to help us, you know, that's what they made the program about. Mm-hmm. And it worked out quite well. We had to go on a train, and we had to write a few things what we were going to say, and then we got down to Plymouth, England. Of course, recordings in those days, they made records. They didn't have tape and stuff. They cut a record. We went down on what they call a barbican. It was right on the shore. And all the seagulls tripping in the background, and they did some recording there, right in front of the, there's a plaque that says the Mayflower left England, and there's some steps.
Did they give you a script, or did they just ask questions and then you would answer them?
I mean. Well, no, they had a script for the whole thing. It was like kind of like a thing that's made up like a show. They used background music from, it was a Navy choir. And they had some people, they were like actors. They had a microphone hanging in the middle, and they went through these motions saying different things in their language and our language. And they say, now we'll talk to the first American. And that's when we had to cut in and say our thing. And then they went back and they said, now, I think it was something like, well, now from these Pilgrims that left Plymouth, England, 1620, now here we have some come back to help. You know, it was kind of set up that way. But also, our parents were notified in Massachusetts, and we were supposed to make it talk back and forth, but the timing was off because that was a recording and was sent over the airways, and then I never got to hear it. It was my mother, and well, my mother and father were down on the, they did their recording down on the waterfront by the Plymouth Rock, but I didn't get to hear it because of the timing, and I was so anxious to get back to the field, so I did.
So you did fly with the whole 35 with your crew then?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me about the 35th mission. I mean, you knew that was your last mission.
Yeah. That was all, and that was our easiest mission. And it was luckily we just went to this airfield right in Holland. It was hardly just barely across the channel, and it didn't take long. The flying time wasn't long or anything, and we get credit for the mission. So when we come back, that was our 35th. But what happened, usually when you finish flying there, they ship you right out. They ship you back to the States. But at that time, I think they took a lot of the ground crew because of the Battle of Bulge, and they sent them over to Europe, I guess, to help give them more troops. Well, those poor guys were like the barbers, I guess they were in different ones, that I guess the ones they figured they could get along without. Well, poor guy's been there probably 2 years without any training. I felt kind of bad about that. I didn't know any of them, but I heard about what had happened. So they asked if you'd mind staying and helping out. And as far as I was concerned, the war was over. I wasn't flying anymore, you know. So the enlistment, most of the enlistment, we stayed, and we did whatever we could. We went down, helped bomb loaders, or we helped. Sometimes we have to get down new crews and kind of show the guy about the top turret, make sure he gets everything set up right and everything. To me, they were kids. I was 20 years old.
Did you feel like you had grown up fast because of this experience?
I think so, because when I had to teach him, he seemed like a kid to me. So we stayed and we were there right till the war ended. And what they did, they took all the crews that hadn't finished, and they put 10 ground crew, and they flew them back to the stateside. And I think they were going to fly them back and train them for B-29s to go down to the Pacific. So we ended up being on the base. We were about the last one off the base. And we were going around cleaning up the hot stands where we used to park the planes and everything, and just we were practically doing nothing. Then finally they sent us over to another bomb group, and then they sent us up to Liverpool.
Let me ask you, was it a little eerie being one of the last crews there?
Yeah, it seemed strange.
Kind of seeing a ghost?
We would get this whole field and nobody's around. You know, I think there were a few other people around, but I said, well, I hope they haven't forgot us. So finally somebody come and said, you got to go over to the 95th bomb group, and they're going to make up a group that's going to go up and catch a boat in Liverpool. Now when we went over, we flew over, when we come home, we had to come back it was a cargo ship. And it just unloaded a whole lot of cases of pet milk. It was still sitting on the pier there. And I had a mattress down in one of the holds, which was good because it was the center of the ship, so it wasn't so rough in the flying. And of course they had loaded with good food and everything. You know, if they knew they were going to bring troops back, they were going back empty, so So we come, but it took us about 9-10 days to come across. And we're headed for New York, and the Queen Mary, I think it was the Mary, it passed us on the ocean. I think in 2 hours' time it showed up and disappeared. And of course, they got into New York way ahead of us, so they're probably unloading so many there. So they changed our course and made us go into Boston. I said, wow, that's good, you know, going back into Massachusetts. So the first thing we saw is they have what they call a Nantucket lightship. It's off the island of Nantucket, which is Massachusetts. And we saw that lightship. I said, boy, I hope we go through the Cape Cod Canal. But it's all fogged in, and so we had to go all around the Cape, and then we didn't come in until the next day. But when we come into Boston Harbor, the fire boats had the hoses and all, you know. So that's quite a, you know, quite a thing, quite a reception. And they had a big signs walking of us home. But,
what was the homecoming like when you went home?
What had happened, we got into this, what they call Camp Miles Standish, which is hardly any distance from Plymouth, Mass. It was not too far away. And then what I had to do was go back up to the other Army camp, further away before I come home. So I got all the way up there, and then I got to look up my pass. So I had to come back into Boston and then get a ride from Boston. So anyway, when I went home, I didn't call my family. I didn't call my mother or anything. So I come walking, and I said, well, I'm home. You know, like I was just down the street.
So, and they were glad to see you.
Yeah.
Had you been able to stay in touch with them when you were over there? Like V-mail or that kind of thing?
Yeah, we used to make that. You used to write on these, the email was a big thing you wrote, and then they took a picture of it and made a small one. I wasn't much of a writer, but, you know, I used to, because you couldn't say anything. I couldn't say anything about the weather. I couldn't say anything about what I was doing. You know, I couldn't say too much about going into London. And so I just, oh, I'm doing okay. And you know, I try to write to my brother and sister when younger, and I write them a couple of letters, tell them to behave themselves, and stay in school and everything. You know.
Where were you when victory in Japan, VJ Day, happened and the whole war was over? What was your circumstances then?
I was still in, and I think I was home on furlough. I know I was, because I had a big time in the town, and they were having they'd made up a parade and everything, which, I don't know, I didn't seem to take part, I didn't want to. I don't know why, I just, you know, I said, well, I'm glad it's over, and I just didn't feel like celebrating at that time.
How long was it then before you were discharged?
Well, that was August, I think, when that war, you know, I got out in October.
You got married, had kids, that kind of thing after?
Well, I got married in 1949. And I have one daughter, Claudia, and one grandson.
And what was your occupation after the war?
Well, I first went into the building trades when I got out of the service. And then I used to hear the old timers complaining about climbing up on these buildings and ladders and everything. I said, gee, is that what I'm coming to? So I decided that I went to night school in Boston. I went to computer school, and I learned about, now this is the old fashioned computers, nothing like, we used to have what they call tabulators in those days, and we used to have the wire boards that went behind this tabulator. And you have to take and plug hundreds of wires, go from one. So I learned all about that, and then I learned about the computer. We had like the old-fashioned IBM punch cards. Mm-hmm. Everything was done punch cards in those days. And of course, as I was there, though, things got better and better and got more modern stuff faster. And then our memory was very limited in those days. But I was in there about 12 years, I think, and I started losing my hearing. The computer rooms in those days, there were large rooms, and the computers were big. And, you know, they had magnetic tape drives, you know, you always probably see them in these computer rooms, these drives. And then, of course, I worked for banks, and the machine that used to read the encoding on the bottom of the checks, they're very, very noisy. And the whole thing combined was over 95 decibels in that computer room. And, of course, we used to have a lot of classes come through, and we'd have to give them tours and everything in those days. And as soon as they opened the door and come in, I'd see them block the ears, you know. I'd say, boy, it's noisy. And of course, I started losing my hearing. And so I went and had a checkup. And matter of fact, I went at the Mass General which is in Boston. And as it turned out, the guy, he was a flight surgeon who was in charge of the ear and throat stuff. He says, "Oh," he says, "no wonder you're deaf." He says, "You flew on those things." He says, "No wonder you're getting deaf." He says, "Well," he says, "you better protect your ears. You better start wearing ear protectors," he says, "because you're not going to make, you know." So because I started not hearing good, and so I finally gave it up, and I went back into the building trades, but I ended up to get a job with the school department in the maintenance department, and that's where I worked the rest of my time, and I retired from there.
Can you believe you were that young when you went over there?
No, I can't now. As I look back, like I was saying before, when I saw my grandson at 18 years old, I said, I can't believe it. I was his age when I was doing all this stuff. And of course, the responsibility, you were kind of on your own. Even if you went to London, you were kind of on your own to get in and get out and do all these different things. And of course, being in the military, so, well, somebody's always guiding you. They're always telling you what to do. But that's not always true sometimes. You have to make a lot of decisions on your own. And hopefully, they'll come out for the best. Well, I think one of the biggest things, too, is with this group having our reunions, And it's really, I think it's brought us together, and I think it's our crew. The crew are like brothers, so it's just.
And that's true. I guess that's the question is, and what I was getting at as far as how everybody related. How close did you get with these guys?
Well, of course, when we first got home, I think we all had to go home. We had to get jobs, and we had to bring up families and everything. But as time went on, and we always stayed in touch, always, at least Christmas cards. Or one member, Sam Lafferty, we used to visit each other. He was in Philadelphia, and of course, he'd come up, and then we'd go down to Philadelphia. And of course, when my daughter was young, we'd take her down, and he had young kids. And so we visited a lot, and then we got Bill Johnson, the one that was wounded. We always stayed in touch with him, and we really are. We're pretty thick that way. It's just like brothers. I don't know. It's hard to explain. I think it's because that you went through this particular thing together, and we survived. And it's just, I don't know. And our wives will all get along great. You know, it's great. And to end up now at these reunions, you know, this, what, four of us here today.